They never give up. They never surrender. This is Founder Quest.
That's how we like to do it.
Yeah, we just like to jump right in there.
We have a guest with us today who is not John Neunemaker for a change. We have Adam McCray from Judo Scale is here, and I'm really excited about this. Adam and I got to hang out at RailsConf recently in Detroit, and that was a lot of fun. Glad you could be here, Adam. To get all official, to get all serious here, suddenly.
It's fun to be here. I appreciate it. And yeah, finally a break from John. I bet everybody's ready for a break from John.
How did I miss you at RailsConf, Adam? I don't remember seeing you.
I caught a glimpse of you at one point and then never saw you again. So I don't know. I don't know how we missed each other.
See, this is why you never leave on the last day. You stay for the whole time, because I think it was the last night that we went out to dinner, wasn't it?
Yeah.
I think it was after Ben left. Somehow I missed you like the whole first half of the conference too. So I was happy to, or I might have like seen you like from afar or something like that. But yeah, glad we got to go out to dinner.
Yeah, I was regretting that choice, but it was really the lesser of two evils, right? My return flight was either going to be at 7 p.m. or at 7 a.m. And since, you know, that was Eastern time and I was heading back to Pacific, I was like, well, I'd much rather fly out at 7 p.m. than 7 a.m. But yeah, I didn't.
I took the 7 a.m. and let me tell you, it was rough.
Yeah, neither of those options sound
no,
fun.
No. So I guess I should have just gone full tilt and gone 7 p.m. the next night, right? Just spent an extra full day in Detroit.
Normally I do the thing you did and I leave like the afternoon. But there's been a few times I've regretted it. So I figured I'd try staying for the whole, you know, through the whole, like last night this time.
And Josh, you just traveled across the country again for Blue Ridge, right?
Yeah, I was just at Blue Ridge Ruby last week. Thursday and Friday were the days of the conference. It was a great conference. I had never been to Asheville, North Carolina. Did I hear that you guys were there one year or last year?
We did go last year. Yeah, we did. Three of us or four of us did a road trip from Columbus, Ohio to Asheville, North Carolina, which was like, it was like a 6 or 7 hour drive. But when we weighed out the flight options, it's like, well, it's going to be about that much travel time anyway, so let's just drive.
Yeah. Plus, you get a road trip with a bunch of software engineers. That sounds like fun.
It was fun, yeah. And it was an awesome conference. So, yeah, I'm glad you got to go this year. I'm glad they did it again this year because it was a great time last year.
Yeah, they did a great job. Joe and Mark organized it this year, and Jeremy got a break, but he still gave us a great keynote at the end of on the last day. And it was really fun. I'll have to put I did a write-up on our blog of a recap of the conference. We'll have to put that in the show notes.
Yeah, I read through it this morning. It was a fun recap. Yeah.
Cool.
Ben, do you have any other conferences you're going to be heading to this year?
Actually, speaking of travel and conferences, I have a bit of a quandary. So I am planning on being at Rails World. And so that's in September. But I was also thinking maybe I want to go to Business of Software this year. That's every year on the East Coast. I think it's in Raleigh now. It used to be in Boston every year. I was like, well, maybe I'll do that. And so I got an email from them and I was like, let me go check that out. And so it's the same week as Rails World, but it's the beginning of the week. So I technically could fly out Sunday night from Seattle to Raleigh and then wrap up the conference on Wednesday, like lunchtime, hop on a plane to Toronto to be there for Thursday morning Rails World, and then fly home on Saturday from Toronto back to Seattle. So I'm trying to decide, do I really want to do that? Because I typically, conference travel is 2 or 3 days and you're done. And that's kind of my sweet spot. So a whole week of traveling is not really my usual. So I don't know. But yes, I'll be at Rails World for sure.
I'm exhausted at the end of a conference. I cannot imagine bouncing from one conference to another.
Yeah. Are you planning on going?
I've never done back-to-back.
I will be at Rails World. Yeah. And I'm super excited about that because I just hired my first full-time developer at Judo Scale, Carlos Antonio da Silva, who's also a Rails Core contributor. He and I used to work together at You Need a Budget or YNAB.
Yeah, I was going to say YNAB. Yeah, I'm a big fan of YNAB.
But yeah, we met each other in person once when we were at YNAB, but that was pretty short. So I'm excited to see Carlos in person. He's going to be at Rails World as well.
Nice.
That's awesome.
Yeah, back to back might be a bit of a bad idea. Like I imagine by Friday I would be pretty fried. So maybe I don't do that.
I remember I did one time, I think I did back to back weeks. So I was like, I went one the first week and then I was home for a few days and then I had another one the next week. I think that was probably that like 2013 or 14 stint that we did where we went to a lot of events, and that was pretty tough, I recall. But you should definitely do it.
You should at least definitely do Rails World.
Yeah, for sure.
and I won't miss you this time.
Yeah. We're going to have to end this by 11 today because I'm going to try to snag a ticket. They're dropping the last batch of tickets for Rails World. And I was kind of on the fence when they did the first one. So I'm going to see if I can grab one. And if I can, then I'll be there. And otherwise, I don't know, maybe I'll come hang out in Toronto anyway.
Yeah, I mean, the first batch was gone in like 20 minutes. So I imagine this batch is going to go even faster.
Got my clicker finger ready to refresh the page.
Well, Josh, what Josh is not saying is that he was kind enough to buy my ticket to Rails World for me during that small window because I was on a plane coming home from a trip and I would have missed it if not for Josh's kindness. So now we got to try and make sure that he can also participate.
Wow.
Yeah. That's just the kind of guy
That's
I am.
True. That's true. I knew he wouldn't brag about it himself, so I had to give him the props.
Well, thank you.
So, Adam, tell us about JudoScale. I'm sure there are probably one or two people who might not know what it is, so let's talk about that.
Yeah, JudoScale is an autoscaler for Heroku and other cloud platforms, such as Render and AWS, but the reality is mostly Heroku. So for 7 years, it's been a Heroku add-on, and just last year, we built an integration to Render and AWS. But yeah, if the native autoscaler on those platforms don't meet your needs, JudoScale steps it up a notch and lets you do things like autoscale your Sidekick workers and autoscale your web stuff based on request queue time rather than response time. So it's just a better autoscaler. That's all it is.
I mean, there are worse ways to make a business than to build a better something than someone else has already built, right? That's a pretty well-worn path of a good product.
Yeah, it has worked. It has worked pretty well.
It is kind of cool how Heroku has built like some simplified features that they allow add-ons to kind of, you know, do the more advanced version.
Yeah, the Heroku add-on marketplace has just been fantastic. JudoScale was a side project for the first 5 years of its existence, and the marketplace let me just throw it in there and not really market it and let it just grow slowly on its own, which was super cool. I was actually thinking before hopping on here that like JudoScale, like I started building it in 2016, launched it in 2017. How old is Honey Badger? You guys are a little older than that, right?
Yeah, we were 2012.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
You guys have been around a long time.
A long time.
I was talking to a friend of mine at church on Sunday, and we were just catching up, and he was asking me about Honey Badger, and it's like, yeah, we've been doing it for 12 years, and et cetera, and he's talking about that, and he's like, man, I've been married for 12 years. That's So for him, that was an interesting kind of perspective. I was like, yeah, that's kind of weird. Yeah.
Yeah, you and Josh have essentially been married for 12 years.
Well, longer. Like, we've been working together for, I don't know, what is it, like 15, 16 years now?
We've been working together longer than I've been married to my wife. Yeah, we're 14 years this year.
And you guys are a team of four now? I was looking at the site before this. The Meet the Badgers page has four of you, I think.
Yeah, there are four people on the About page, but we have one hidden employee because he was just recently added and we haven't gotten around to putting him on the page. Is my son actually has been working for us lately. That's been fun. First, to be honest, I wasn't quite sure how it was going to go because working for your dad can be a weird experience, but it's been fantastic. I love having him work for us and he's done some great work and he's going to be editing this podcast audio. So he's going to be hearing me talk about how awesome he is. So go Addison. But yeah, we got to update our about page and get that. So we're five people.
Yeah, we should do that. I've also been really enjoying having Addison around and it's been super helpful with everything. That Honey Badger banner went off real. It was perfect at the conference. So nice work, Addison. We had him do a like roll up banner for whatever, you know, next to the conference entrance.
At which one? At RailsConf or at?
That was at Blue Ridge.
Okay.
Yeah. So I actually had to travel with like this, whatever the banner comes in like this carrying case and I had to like check it and, you know, everyone thought it was like a MIDI keyboard or something. Unfortunately, it wasn't that cool.
That would be cool to have at conferences, though. You know, so we do a sponsorship and we have a booth and you're sitting there doing some tunes on the keyboard.
I should do that. Yeah, I should. That would be pretty fun, actually.
You guys always have just like really creative conference, not just conferences, like every part of the Honey Badger brand and stuff is always just like creativity is just kind of oozes from. Who is the creative genius, or is it both of you, or is it all of you?
I don't know. We all have some pretty good ideas, and then I think like it all synthesizes, and then I'm usually the one who executes. I handle most of our marketing these days, although I gotta like give credit to in the past to Star and Ben Finley when he was here. Definitely been a team effort. But yeah, I definitely like the weird creative projects.
Who does all the, you guys have a lot of custom artwork for like your swag, for, I mean, I think like the Exceptional Creatures stuff and just all throughout the website and stuff. Does somebody on the team an artist, or is that stuff that you contract out?
So a lot of our artwork on the website and on our t-shirts that you've seen in the past is by an artist called Kyle. His name's Kyle Schold, and he hasn't been doing our art lately, but yeah, he's a really good artist. I met him locally up here in the Pacific Northwest. He's done a lot of the art for like a lot of the breweries, like local breweries around here, like their labels for their beers and things. So love his style. And then the Exceptional Creatures was actually illustrated by my wife, Kaylin. She's an artist. And yeah, we worked on it together. Actually, I have a few creatures I need to add to the page. I've been meaning to get back around to that. But yeah, that was a lot of fun. And then I've got a new t-shirt design I'm hopefully working on with a cool artist. I've been telling a few people this story, but there's this artist that has done, so there's this company, a skate company called Santa Cruz Skateboards, some people might have heard of, that is out of Santa Cruz, California. And they're like one of the old school, like really well-known skate companies from when skateboarding kind of blew up in the 70s, I think. And their art is like really well known because they've had the same artist for years. And actually it's now passed on to his son, who's been doing their art since, I don't know, for the last 10, maybe, I'm not sure how long, over 10 years. But I like randomly emailed him and he's going to work on some art for us. So I'm pretty excited about that.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah.
But yeah, like
try
just
to take some.
Sorry, go ahead.
I'm going to try to take some inspiration from you guys, and Judo Skill needs a little more creativity behind our marketing efforts. We haven't actually had swag in, like, haven't even made t-shirts since we rebranded from Rails Auto Scale to Judo Scale, which at this point has been over 2 years, probably almost 3 years at this point. Mostly just because I haven't really liked our logo. And so I just recently had worked with my brother to redesign our logo. So gonna start plastering that on some things and actually.
Nice.
Have some swag. It was very sad to go to RailsConf and not even be able to wear a shirt for my own company, let alone have some to give away or anything like that.
Yeah, I have one of your shirts from back before somewhere. I remember it was at a RailsConf. I'm trying to remember what one it was. I can't remember if it was before the pandemic or not. It's like a blur, but yeah, I got a shirt from you at one point. Yeah, so well, that's cool. Yeah, I like my thing with shirts is just like, just make a good one. Pick good material, and like a nice design is a good thing as well. But just like when I see companies like, you know, buy the cheap shirts that don't fit well, I'm just like, why do that? Because if people don't want to wear it, like what's the point of making it? I remember yours was really well done.
Yeah, thank you. I appreciate that. I remember that conference. I brought a whole bunch of shirts with me. Just to give away, like I wasn't a sponsor or anything. I didn't have the money to be a sponsor, but I just had like a suitcase of shirts and was just trying to like give them away. And that was a huge pain because you got to bring an assortment of sizes. So here's my idea. I'm just going to like throw out an idea and see what you guys think. For Rails World, I just want to have like a QR code that anybody can scan, and then that's just going to take them up to a page. Just like, just put in your address. I'm going to send you a shirt, but I'm not bringing a bunch of shirts to the conference.
So we've done that. We've done that. We use PrintFection for a lot of our swag fulfillment. And we basically, what they do is, you know, you can send them or have them print a bunch of inventory and a variety of sizes and whatever. And then you can have individual redemption links, which you can generate via their API. What we do is we actually have in our little admin tool that we built for ourselves, we have a page where we can call that API. And we have a QR code generator on that page so that when we're at a conference, we can open up our phone, we can generate a new link, show somebody that QR code, and then they can hit that and go to the PrintFection page to enter in their address and get it filled for them. Because yeah, we had the same problems. Like you show up at a conference, you got the suitcase. For one, you got to get the suitcase of shirts there. That's a pain in the butt. You got to drag that through the airport, and sometimes it gets left in a cab, as Josh well knows.
Or at bag check. You left at bag check, and you drive like 30 minutes to Pittsburgh, and then have to come back. You have to drive all the way back in rush hour traffic.
And then once you get it there, you got to hand them out, and you probably run out of the larges or the extra larges before you run out of the smalls and the mediums, you know, and then you don't have any to give out to people that want them. And so, yeah, the QR code has worked out pretty well for us. The downside is you have individual shipping charges now versus, you know, just bringing the box. But all things considered, I think we decided it's worth it to pay the extra shipping costs.
Yeah, I feel like, I mean, on the flip side, if you make a bunch of shirts, like, I still have probably 50 Rails Auto Scale shirts that are basically just rags now. Like, a lot of rags. Never going to run out of rags at home. I just got all these shirts that I don't know what to do with. So, yeah, I think I'd rather just, like, pay extra for each individual shirt to ship them individually than just have to deal with inventory, just having all these shirts around.
Yeah. Yeah, I highly recommend it if you can make that happen.
It's also enabled us to have that as a giveaway promotion sometimes in the app. So we've done at various times, like, hey, if you enter your payment information before your trial is done, then you can get this shirt. And then we just respond. So we ask them to respond to us and let us know they did that. And then we send them an email with a link that they can then get the fulfillment done for themselves. So it's pretty handy. It's not the cheapest thing in the world, but it's fun to do things like that. And people like that stuff.
Yeah, we actually have a shirt offer right now still going for people who send production data to Honey Badger Insights, our new logging observability tool. And so you can go to honeybadger.io/2, then like the number 2, legit, and that we have a little landing page for that shirt. It's a fun like honey badger and a elephant. The elephant is supposed to be like, it was when we first did that design, we were trying to do like a honey badger PHP, like Laravel sort of thing. So we did that like a PHP elephant character. Kyle did that for us, but it's a fun limited edition Honey Badger shirt.
So yeah, highly recommend the not bringing a whole box of shirts. But you know, if you've got 50 shirts left over, maybe I guess you can take them down to Goodwill or something. Somebody will pick those up and have some shirts.
They're going to have some collector's items.
Yep. So I'm interested. You mentioned you moved, you started Heroku, and then you added ECS, which we use here at Honey Badger quite a bit. So I'm familiar with that. But we don't use Render. And I was kind of interested in that since I'm not familiar with it as much. How does the auto-scaling with Render work compared to the others? Is it pretty much the same kind of thing?
Yeah, it's pretty much the same kind of thing. On basically any of these platforms, we have an integration library that lives in your app. So if you've got a Rails app, it's a gem that you install, so that we can measure request queue time, how requests are queuing up in Puma, which is basically a measure of how at capacity you are. We measure that, report it up to Judo scale, and so that just works the same whether you're on Heroku, whether you're on Render, whether you're on ECS. Then the only difference is on the Judo scale server side, you know, are we scaling up Heroku dynos, Render instances, or Amazon ECS tasks? But basically, works the same no matter what platform you're on.
That's cool.
The only difference is like with Heroku, we're able to automate a lot of the installation steps because you're installing it through the Heroku marketplace. So when you install the Heroku add-on, we get some API access to be able to scale your application. Mm. Whereas on Render, there's not like a marketplace. So it's more of a, you sign up through judoscale.com and then we give you an environment variable that you need to set within your app. And you need to give us API access. So there's just a little bit more setup that needs to happen. But at the end of the day, it all works the same.
And it'd be like the same story with ECS too, right? You have to give privileges to the account to be able to call the APIs for you and that sort of thing.
Yeah, I had to do the IAM dance and all that stuff. Yeah, which, I mean, that was the hardest part for us because I don't have much experience with AWS. So building that integration just, you know, required a lot of getting familiar with how all the permission stuff works.
Well, I have to give you props on your gem, speaking of monitoring Puma and spinning up things based on those statistics. So we recently have undergone a dev cycle where we're just wrapping up, where we've added a bunch of instrumentation, automatic instrumentation to our gem that we can report to Insights. So the goal being you add the Honey Badger gem or upgrade your Honey Badger gem to the latest version, and now you enable one feature and you're going to send a bunch of stats to Insights like Puma backlog and request latency and that sort of thing. And so what we did is we made a list of all the gems, maybe probably not all, but a good chunk of the gems that do this kind of monitoring, and yours was in the list. And yeah, we got compliments from Roel, who did this work on your gem in particular, on how clean it was, nice it was to look at and to get those kind of statistics out of there.
Oh, that's awesome. That is mostly Carlos's work. from a couple years ago, he did like a short contract with me just working on the gem stuff. So yeah, I'll pass that along to him. But it's definitely, I've been really happy with how that has turned out. It's been easy to work with.
Nice job, Carlos.
Yeah. Unlike our other integration libraries, I've spent like the past 2 or 3 weeks working on our Node integration. Mm-hmm. It's just kind of amazed me how difficult it's been for me, because I don't think I'm a bad programmer. I think I'm okay, and I know JavaScript, but I don't really know the Node like ecosystem and all this stuff. So it's just been one thing after another, just in terms of getting things packaged correctly and getting things set up correctly, and do I need a build process? Do I not need a build process? Just all these things that have been not fun to deal with. I'm ready to be back on Ruby.
Yeah, we feel that for sure.
For sure.
I think like out of our, if you like measure the whatever, have a pie chart of the work we put into our client libraries, like JavaScript is probably like, I don't know, like half or, you know.
Or more. Yeah.
It's a lot. Or more.
Because yeah, there's so many flavors. And we get support requests from every kind of combination you can imagine. It's like, oh, I'm running this Nuxt app, but I'm doing this other build tool, and I've got this background thing. And it's like, what? You know, it's like, I haven't heard of two of those things.
Ben, I remember you saying you've been actually enjoying writing some Go mm-hmm. lately. So I take it you haven't had those kinds of, or maybe you've just worked through them, but like, has it been a struggle getting familiar with the Go ecosystem, or have you been able to pick it up pretty quickly?
I wouldn't say it's a struggle, because there's typically, you know, one approved way to do a thing, right? Or maybe two. There's not 50 gajillion frameworks in Go for any given task, right? It's like, well, there are a number of routers, like web routers. That's interesting. There's, I don't know, five or six probably popular ones. But in most cases in Go, it's like, oh, just use this library. Everybody uses this thing, so just use that thing. Or do it this way, right? Versus whatever is the flavor of the month kind of thing. So that's, it's more straightforward.
And the Go standard library also has like, it's very complete. It has something for most things that you would want to do, even if there are like alternative maybe packages now. I just remember when I learned it, like it was a while ago, but I was really impressed that it had like a lot of official things built in, like web servers and things like that.
Yeah. And then in the later versions of Go, like I was just reading yesterday, like version 1.21, I think, they just brought in a new standard lib for structured logging, slog. There's been zero log, which a lot of people use, and there have been a couple others. And so it seems like they're on this happy path of like, okay, we kind of like Rails does sometimes, where you see gems that end up in Rails, like after it's been, you know, a certain amount of popularity. Mm-hmm. And then Go is just like, okay, now it's in the standard library, so just use that, right? Don't worry about all those other ones that are out there.
Yeah, I really like that approach of having all of that officially maintained.
Yeah.
And in the language. It's pretty cool.
Yeah, I think we could use a bit more of that in the Rails world, to be honest. I like that part of the Laravel world where it's like, oh, you know, there's a difference there because it's typically one corporate entity that's behind it. but it is nice to have like, this is the thing that you do, right? As opposed to these are the six different options you could choose from. But I think really the pain that I have with JavaScript is just the churn. It's like, oh, you know, this month, this is the best way. And, you know, 6 months later, oh, no, that's crap. This is the best way. So at least stick with something for a while. That would be nicer.
I think you really nailed it, just like with the everyone's app. Everyone has a different framework that they're using. If you like have all the different combinations, I'm sure you could do some math to like figure out like how many combinations given all the popular frameworks that are out there. But Adam, you don't have to do any client side. You said it's more Node you're dealing with. Just be happy that you don't have client side JavaScript to deal with on top of this. Cause we have a universal package which has to work in the browser and in Node, because some people do both at the same time. You know, like you got like server rendering React for the client side. There has to be like parity on either end. And it's interesting.
That sounds horrible. Yeah, I'm glad. I am thankful that I've only had to deal with the server-side JavaScript for this.
So you have Ruby support, you have JavaScript support. Are there other platforms that you support as well?
We support Python as well. And I did not. Well, I wrote the first version of that, and it was pretty gnarly. So I ended up finding a Python developer to rewrite it, mm-hmm. somebody who actually knows Python and knows the ecosystem. And he did a great job. He's actually still helping out a little, you know, a few hours each month, just like handling customer support issues that are specifically dealing with Python, because I have limited knowledge there. And if somebody, so one of the Python background like job queuing systems is called Celery. So like we've had a few customer support tickets dealing with Celery recently. It's like, oh, my queues aren't showing up. And I'm just like, man, I have no idea.
Yeah.
I'm very happy that I have somebody else that can please look into this because this is too much.
That's been our approach for the client libraries for the most part. I mean, like we built a lot of them like you in the earlier days, but having a contractor for each one, the subject matter expert works, that's a pretty good fit for contractors we found.
Yeah. So how many do you guys have at this point? Not contractors, but libraries.
Yeah. I don't know.
Lost count. It's quite a few. And we've been, we got the basics. We got Ruby, Python, JavaScript, Go. We have Elixir. We have, I think someone did Clojure. I think someone might have done Haskell. And I know someone did .NET. That's all I can think of off the top of my head.
And then don't forget, like, we have React Native and Cocoa and a few native ones as well, Java.
Yeah. So, yeah. And having the contractors has been a lifesaver because, like, I don't know anything about Java, right? And I know very little about Cocoa. So having contractors who actually know that stuff has been super helpful. One problem that we encountered that Josh has done a really good job dealing with is like, you know, you get a contractor who's working with you for a few months and then you're not giving them a full-time job. So they go find something else to do. And maybe after a while, they don't have any time to work with you anymore. And so you got to bring someone else up to speed. It's like, okay, we got to replace that person. And so Josh has done a really good job of documenting our processes and how does our open source approach work and how do you get stuff into a client library, regardless of which one you're working on. And that's been super helpful in getting new contractors spun up pretty quickly. And so now we can basically go to Upwork and we can be like, hey, I need a whatever person that knows Python. Like our current Python contractor came from Upwork.
Yeah. And it works well with even if it's someone on Twitter or Mastodon, it's like, hey, I got some time. And you're like, hey, well, we have some whatever Elixir work available. We use SignWell for signing the contract. So we just have a contract ready to go. You just sign the contract. And then we have a whole just a short checklist onboarding process to get someone in. And then the documentation we have them read through it to learn how we do things. And then hopefully there's issues waiting for them to work on. So it's pretty streamlined, even if it's not on a platform like Upwork. But we've had pretty good luck with Upwork lately as well.
Yeah, definitely. An area that I need to improve on is getting better about documenting processes within the business. And like I said, yeah, Carlos is my first full-time hire, and I've had a few contractors work on a few things, but definitely don't have that sort of repeatable process ironed out like that, which sounds pretty great.
I'm curious about how the rebrand went. That's not something that everyone does. You said it's been a couple of years since you rebranded as JudoScale from Rails AutoScale?
Yeah. Obviously, when you start a product called Rails AutoScale, makes it hard to then branch beyond Rails. But I wanted to. Obviously, there's a lot more developers out there than just Rails developers, and JudoScale the AutoScaler could be useful for all of them. Knew we wanted to branch out beyond Rails, so thought we need a new name because Rails AutoScale just doesn't make sense. The hard part about rebranding was that as a Heroku add-on, you can't rename a Heroku add-on. We couldn't just say, oh, the Rails AutoScale Heroku add-on is now JudoScale. So we actually had to spin up a new Heroku add-on, which meant we had to go through the barriers of when you want to create a Heroku add-on and get into the marketplace, you have to get 15 customers before you're even in the marketplace. And even then, you've got a beta flag and you can't charge anybody until you get 100 more customers. So 115 people need to install your add-on before you can even start charging money for it. We had to go through all of that a second time with JudoScale. So that was kind of painful. Other than that, it went pretty well. We do still have both add-ons in the marketplace because I didn't want to just like shut down Rails AutoScale. We still have hundreds of customers using it. So it's a little weird that we have two add-ons in the Heroku marketplace. Different names, but they're, if you install one, it's the same back-end app. Everything is exactly the same. There's one database, no matter which add-on you install. There's one app running in the back end.
Interesting.
Yeah, for the most part, it hasn't resulted in much customer confusion, I don't think. I still haven't heard a lot about it.
Can you still install the Rails AutoScale version, or is it just for existing? Okay. So, like, has JudoScale, I assume JudoScale surpassed it in the marketplace. When people search for autoscaling, I'm wondering is there any confusion there?
If you search in the marketplace, there's actually, I think Heroku sorts it randomly. honestly. Like, I don't, yeah, there's nothing you can do to boost yourself in the rankings or anything like that. And it just, I think it is like a random ordering.
Okay. Yeah.
So, yeah, people do still install Rails Autoscale. On the marketplace page for Rails Autoscale, it does say Rails Autoscale is now JudoScale. You can go here. But I didn't want to put anything on there like, don't install this, or don't, or, you know, I could have even disabled all the plans so that you couldn't install it. I don't want to do anything that's going to potentially have somebody land there and be like, well, I can't use this thing, so I'm going to go find something else. So if they want to install it as Rails Autoscale, they still can.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, even in Google, Rails Autoscale still outranks JudoScale for a lot of things. But
interesting, yeah.
Yeah. At the end of the day, it doesn't matter that much to us which one they sign up for.
Yeah. I'm surprised Heroku doesn't have a way to just migrate or, like, you know, rebrand an existing add-on or something like that. That seems like a lot of extra work you had to do.
Yeah, I was surprised too.
But, it really, you know, feels like, having worked with their add-on stuff, it really feels like it's a rotisserie chicken. You know, they just set it and forget it. It feels like they built it and they got it to a certain point and it works, and now they haven't looked at it again in like 8 years or whatever.
I mean, it kind of felt that way for a lot of parts of Heroku for a long time. Since really just in the last year or two, it seems like they've started taking it seriously and making improvements and even hiring. I'm excited to see the things that they're doing, yeah. That they are actually doing things now.
That's great to hear. I love Heroku and I'm glad they're making it better.
I'm happy to hear you say that after having read your blog post about the experiment with the router 2.0.
Yeah. I'll give a quick summary there. So Heroku has a new router which supports HTTP 2.0 amongst other things, and it's in beta right now, and so you can try the router. And so we were like, yeah, let's try the new router. We swapped it over in our staging app, and it worked fine. So we swapped it over in production, and our app just completely fell apart. But we're like, all right, that's all right. A few minutes, the latency just started climbing, no matter how many dynos we ran. It was like, I don't know what's going on. Let's just switch back to the old router. Switched back to the old router. And it got even worse. And after about a half hour, we're like, I don't know what else to do to salvage our app. No matter how many dynos we run, like, we're just getting timeouts. And the actual time spent in Rails was still very short, like 10, 20 milliseconds, really, really quick responses. But our overall response time was still terrible. And there seemed to be nothing we could do to bring it down. So we ended up completely rebuilding our production app on Heroku. Spin up like Heroku Create and JudoScale Prod 2 is now our production app on Heroku.
Wow.
So yeah, that was not fun. And I'm still working with Heroku to get to the bottom of what happened there. I think they did find a bug internally for how connections are held onto when you switch routers, and that seems to be part of the problem. But yeah, still working with their networking team to figure out what happened there.
Yeah, that sounds like an ordeal.
Yeah.
Yeah, not a fun way to spend a Saturday morning, but I mean, I brought it upon myself. Like, we didn't have to try the new fancy thing. We really didn't need it. I just thought, Heroku has a new thing. I want to try it. We also did not load test our staging environment with the new router. There's definitely some of the responsibility falls on us.
Yeah, that's one of those, this is going to end the business kind of hair on fire kind of moments where you're just like, take a deep breath. We'll get through this.
Yeah, I was thankful to have Carlos, because he happened to see like all the alerts piling into Slack, and he's like, something going on? Do you need any help? I'm like, yeah, hop on Tuple with me, please. I don't want to do this alone.
Oh, man. Yeah, that must have been so nice to have someone. I just can't imagine like dealing with that as a solo, just by yourself.
I mean, that's the way it's been for 7 years. Anytime something went wrong, it was just me on my own.
That just makes me thankful for my co-founder. Yeah.
Yeah, it is definitely nice to be able to swap off some of that responsibility and share that load. It helps a lot for the mental state. Well, Josh, I guess we got to get you out of here so you can get ready to click that mouse, refresh that web page.
Got about 15 minutes until Rails World launch, so we'll see. Cross your fingers for me.
So oftentimes, Adam, we share like what we've been doing recently or what we're going to be doing next. We talked about how we have the gem update coming real soon, and we also have some Rails dashboards coming out on top of that instrumentation. Basically, if you start seeing that instrumentation data, we'll show you a new dashboard, the Rails dashboard, that has pretty charts automatically done for you, and we're looking forward to having that out there. We're using it ourselves, and it's pretty cool. And then doing that some other platforms as well. But yeah, Adam, do you have anything cooking up that you want to talk about?
We're just getting started on a new project to make some big changes for how we handle log-based autoscaling. So if you're using like a language that we don't have an integration library for, like I said, we have Node, Python, and Ruby. But if you're using Java, if you're using PHP, Go, anything like that, we don't have an integration library, but you can still autoscale your app based on response time, which we just get from Heroku's router logs. But we're going to be diving into getting some more data out of those logs so that it's useful. Like as soon as you install it, you don't have to install an integration library right away. It's just going to be like immediately you start seeing some useful data and you can start autoscaling. And then if we have an integration library available for your stack, we'll offer it and you can use that. But just trying to make JudoScale more useful for everybody rather than just the select few that we have an integration adapter for.
Nice. Yeah, there's a lot of data in those router logs. We've spent some time on that for when we built out Insights and parsing that data. And like some of the add-ons, we'll put metrics back in there, like Redis and Postgres. We'll dump some metrics in there so you can keep an eye on those things and not have to have an actual agent running. So that's cool.
Maybe we'll have to have a Honey Badger JudoScale integration of some kind in the future. It'd be cool. Could scale based on your Insights log stream or something.
I know from being a JudoScale customer with one of my clients that JudoScale does put those kind of events back into the logs that you can pick up in the Heroku logs. So yeah, we could definitely pull that into Insights so you can know when scaling is
happening. We have like an auto-scaling dashboard. Yeah, that would be cool.
Let's get on that.
Love it.
Cool, Adam. This has been fun to chat. It's been fun to hang out with you.
Thanks for having me, guys. This has been great.
Yeah, Ben and I have been really enjoying talking to founders like Adam and John, and we're hoping to have some more friends of the pod on in the future. One thing that listeners can do to help boost our rankings and get more people listening is go give us a review in your podcast platform. And otherwise, you can find us at founderquestpodcast.com.
FounderQuest is a weekly podcast by the founders of Honey Badger. Zero instrumentation, 360-degree coverage of errors, outages, and service degradations for your web apps. If you have a web app, you need it. Available at honeybadger.io. Want more from the founders? Go to founderquestpodcast.com. That's one word, where you can access our huge back catalog of episodes. FounderQuest is available on iTunes, Spotify, and other purveyors of fine podcasts. We'll see you next week.